years of firsts and first-class performances. As producers used to say to him after a long day of driving, hauling cable, cameras, lights, and videotapes, "Thank you, Gene." And for him, that was enough.
Few people have navigated the creative waters between public and commercial TV as successfully as our next presenter. In the 1960s, she began at NBC in Chicago, rising to the position of community affairs manager and public affairs talk show host. That time, that was something wonderful. Today, a talk show about public affairs has taken on a little bit of a different connotation, but it wasn't that way in the 60s. From there, she went to the most watched PBS station in the country, WTTW, before heading west to Burbank as program director for the NBC-owned station in Los Angeles. She returned home to Chicago in 1993, becoming the director of program information at the Mayor's Office of Employment and Training. The following year, she was tapped to be general manager of WYCC, Channel 20. She's also a member of the TV Academy Board of Governors. Let's welcome Carol Cartwright.
Good afternoon. You know, Gene's career really had two different phases. And those of you who have been in front of the camera can identify with this. If you've ever been saved by an engineering professional, if your story has ever made the air because someone helped you to get it together when everything seemed to be failing, you can appreciate a Eugene Cartwright. Gene was the kind of engineer who, as one director put it, would hold dry ice against a generator that didn't want to work on the bid move while everybody else went to lunch. He's just that creative kind of engineer and professional that everybody who's working either on camera or producing wants to have on the team. And that is what we tried to show you on the tape. You know, it really is fascinating to think, as I think back over my career, that we have been in this historic position of watching an actual transition from film to videotape, and now we're going into digital. Today's producers think about minicams as, well, sure, let's take the camera, let's go. For us, that was not quite that simple. We had to think about, well, where can we go with 500 foot of cable? So things have changed, and there are few people who've been as fortunate as Gene and I to really see the transition of one phase of broadcasting to another. And in Gene's case, of course, from radio to color, to videotape, and where we are now. So it's just a fantastic opportunity today for me, especially since Gene happens to be my husband, to present this award to him. The second phase of his career, after he got through with saving all of the producers and helping people and convincing everybody that videotape was really the medium of the future, was in management. And in this room today, there are people that Gene has hired, has nurtured, and I think that that's one of the most important contributions he's made really to the industry, and that is being able to recognize the talent of the people who can motivate others. Gene has hired countless people who didn't think that they had a chance to make it in broadcasting, but he recognized something in them that would enable them to be successful. I kind of count myself as one of those. Even though he didn't hire me, I can say that my management style, my style of production, my attitude toward what broadcasting is and should be was largely formulated by knowing Gene Cartwright. So I'm very pleased today to have the honor of being able to present him with the Silver Circle Award. And unlike other presenters, I can say that I'm going to go to bed with him tonight.
Thank you. Well, after 41 years in engineering, I'm much more accustomed to being on the other end of one of these things. But I'll try my best to overcome my jitters. I would like to echo something that Walter said. I went to work every day saying, boy, what is going to happen today? I never got up and said, oh, I don't want to go to work. And of course, then I had the pleasure and experience of working with Carol for almost 10 years out in the field. And just to close off this very brief statement of mine, this is the second time I've been inducted into a Silver Circle in this last year. Carol and I celebrated 25 years of marriage last September.
Tends to be somewhat difficult at times because there's so much to look back on, particularly when I try to single out the highlights of my experience.
Our next presenter was a Chicago firefighter who broke into TV as a part-time news film courier at Channel 5. Eventually, he became a reporter. And in 1963, won a Chicago Emmy for the very first story he put on the air. 8 more Emmys followed. In 1981, he moved to WLS-TV as general assignment reporter, and just last year, retired from ABC7. In his years as a reporter, he has managed to convince 115 accused murderers to turn themselves into the Chicago police. Last year he was here as a Silver Circle inductee. This year he returns as a presenter. Russ Ewing.
Thank you very kindly. I'm honored to have been asked to say something about my friend Harry Porterfield. It was in 1964 when a news director who had vision hired Harry Porterfield as a news writer. He was there for about 2 or 3 years, and then he was put on the weekend anchor team. Of course, I knew Harry would move further than that, and it didn't take too long. It wasn't too long before Harry got to be a regular anchor from time to time. Now, among his peers, the cameramen, sound men, Harry is known as a gentleman. And he's one of the few reporters in this town who is a true gentleman. Harry has great concern for the people that he does stories with. I have seen Harry refuse to go and run up and stick a microphone in the face of someone who's just lost her son or daughter, while other reporters just want to get the story and get back and forget about it the next day. Harry has heart. He has concern for people. And believe it or not, as a result of that attitude, he gets a lot more than some others do. Because it just, people understand, and they can get, he has empathy and feeling for everyone that he does stories about. Now, it hasn't always been smooth sailing for Harry. There was another news director who came to town and didn't treat Harry in the way that some people felt he shouldn't. He should have been treated. When that happened, there was a great uproar in some neighborhoods. Neighborhood organizations got together and protested, picketed the station. And I was there one day when this group asked Harry to come out and speak to them. Harry went out. He thanked them so much for being concerned about him. But he said, I don't engage in these kind of things. And he had nothing to do with it. And he was respected so much more for that attitude. Harry, of course, is a married man. His wife is Mary Anita, and he has four children. And I happen to have learned that in the next two or three days, one of his children will accept a PhD. I can also remember a day when Harry and I were talking, and there was a young girl who was trying to get a job in television, and she was asking us together, what should I put on my resume and my application that I have done that might help me to get a job in television? Well, I told her that. I said, nowadays, news directors are hiring everybody who was involved in the OJ trial, so stick that on there, that might help a little bit. I understand they just hired the victim's father the other day. And of course, Harry, being more serious than I am most of the time, he gave her good advice. And incidentally, that young lady got a job. I'm so happy about that. For years, I have been calling Harry Mr. Porterfield, or Harry Porterfield, our old friend. But now, I have to refer to him as Attorney Harry Porterfield. A lot of you didn't know that, I'm sure. At least I hope you didn't. In all the things that Harry has done, he has concern for everybody. The homeless man on the street is as important to Harry as the CEO of large corporations. I'm happy to call Harry one of my friends, and most of all, there's no question that Harry is someone you should know. Harry.
This is to Attorney Porterfield.
Ross, just for that, I'll wave my feet. You know, it's difficult for me to talk about myself when I've spent so much time talking about other people, especially people who have given so much of themselves and risen to levels of heroes in the interest of improving the lives of their fellow man. I'm thinking of people I have profiled who have overcome awesome difficulties and disabilities and continue to give of themselves in order to make a difference in the lives of other people. And I'm thinking of a gentleman I profiled who spent nearly 30 years as a dialysis patient, and he has achieved something of a record. But more than that, he was able to raise his family going to dialysis three times a week. I'm thinking of a teacher I met on the South Side who suffers from recurring malignancies. She told me she can actually feel the bumps inside her head as they reoccur. But she continues her classroom work because she is concerned about her students. And I remember particularly a woman who works all day with retarded kids, gets on a CTA bus for 2 hours, then spends the evenings helping terminally ill AIDS patients, and then goes home to cook dinner for her family. Given all the people I have profiled who have so selflessly and generously, even in the face of personal hardships, to help others, I find that my efforts seem quite small by comparison. I am deeply honored and I am humbled by what you have bestowed upon me today, and I hope I can continue to be deserving of this very special recognition. Thank you so much.
A broadcast pioneer and author, our next presenter served as general manager of Channel 7 for 11 years. In the 1960s, he helped launch WFLD-TV decades before it was a Fox station. He is credited with creating the first local talk show format and for giving Bob Newhart his starting show in television. I did Bob's first national shot on the PAR show when he first came in, and the rest, he made history. He is past president of the Chicago Advertising Club, a 1992 inductee into the Chicago Journalism Hall of Fame, and also a 1994 Silver Circle honoree. After a distinguished career in Chicago broadcasting, he is now communications consultant specializing in companies and services involved in new technology. Ladies and gentlemen, Chicago broadcast legend, Sterling Red Quinlan. It's an obstacle course, Red.
Before I make any remarks, we should see a 2 or 3 minute tape of this legendary man, who I'll tell you more about when we finish. This tape was put together from material from the Museum of Broadcast Communications, thanks to Bruce Dumont, and the editing was done by Rhino Werlingrath, whom you will see in the tape. He came to Chicago in 1940 with Bill Eddy. And I don't know where he is here. I hope he is, because I want to thank him, because this tape is quite unusual. And Tom Weinberg also helped. Now, we owe thanks to my old alma mater, Channel 7. Fran Preston, who was here, loaned the editing suite to Werenreth and Weinberg. And Emily Barr, who is not here today, I want to thank both of them. So if the projectors will roll that tape, then I'll pick up after that. Thank you.
Who was at the right time to be a true pioneer of Chicago television?
The light's terrible up here. Can't see my script. Well, who would you name as the dominant geniuses of television technology? You got a clue? You tell me where they are, and I'll send you a bucket of good gin. Here's my list. Philo Farnsworth, for certain, first on anyone's list in the United States. Vladimir Zvorykin, the Russian-American citizen who invented the iconoscope tube, without which there would be no image orthogon tube and no television. Then I would include Commodore Eugene McDonald, founder of Zenith Corporation. He achieved 441 line transmission on the Zenith experimental license W9XEV in 1939. But then he withdrew from producing programs for the system. In the early 50s, he pioneered Phonovision, a pay TV system which was hooked up to 300 Chicago households. It was a scramble system, but it was not quite successful enough to succeed. Then comes the guy you've already learned about just now, Captain William Eddy of the U.S. Navy. He was a true genius and a character you would never forget if you had ever met him. He's about 7 feet tall, cadaverously skinny, almost totally deaf from injuries suffered in the Navy. If he thought you were a bore, he'd turn off his hearing aid, which he invented, and would just stare at you with a big contagious grin, nod his head as if he understood every word. He was a character of diverse facets and talent. He had at least, I believe, 37 patents. Some say they numbered to 100, but I don't think it was that high. He built his own airplane, but it blew up on him. At Annapolis, he rigged a small radio transmitter to warn fellow students of surprise inspections. On a more serious level, he invented a device to display the signal from enemy submarines on a dial. After the war, he joined RCA and pioneered techniques in lighting and special effects. He also was a top drawer cartoonist and caricaturist. He was an artist at sculpture, painting, and computer imaging. He was an aviator, a pioneer in television research, and the creator of the first television station in Chicago and the third in the United States. The Tribune called him the 20th century Marco Polo. He brought to the medium some of the brightest stars before they were on any other station because they were the third oldest station. All the others came known.